I tend to see executive privilege as a constitutionally based power and a legitimate presidential power. On the other hand, it is a limited one and one subject to a balancing test where we have to take into account the needs of the other branches of government. I tend to see executive privilege as a constitutionally based power and a legitimate presidential power. On the other hand, it is a limited one and one subject to a balancing test where we have to take into account the needs of the other branches of government. It is not an absolute power, as Mr. Nixon had asserted during the Watergate crisis. He had made the comment famously that when the president does it, that means it's not illegal, and that presidents have the right to withhold any and all information from those seeking to investigate the executive branch. And his attorney even argued before the Supreme Court that he was merely requesting the court's guidance on the issue, but that he did not accept the legitimacy of the court to decide the matter. It is up to the president alone to determine his own Article II-based powers. Now, I clearly do not agree with that position, nor do I agree with the position that there is no constitutional basis for executive privilege whatsoever. So I hope what I'm presenting today is a bit more of a balanced assessment about this principle. And I've written a great deal on the topic, and I've been both called entirely too deferential to presidents and entirely too deferential to Congress and not respectful of presidents' needs. So I hope that means I've gotten something right on the subject. But executive privilege, as you may know, is the principle that the president may withhold information from those who have compulsory power, congressional investigators, special prosecutors, independent counsels. It is based on the principle that the president has the right to secrecy in the Oval Office, that presidential aides should have the expectation that they can deliberate with candor with the president without fear of public disclosure of their every utterance. It is based also on the principle that occasionally secrecy is necessary to the effective conduct of the presidency, that in such areas as national security or protecting the privacy or secrecy of internal deliberations in the Department of Justice, most people would agree that secrecy is a necessary function of the executive branch. And so Raoul Berger had made the argument in the 1970s that the phrase executive privilege never even existed until the 1950s, which he's absolutely right about. That was not a part of our common language until the Eisenhower administration. But here I think he was playing a little bit of a word game, because you can find various constitutionally based powers that are routinely exercised today that are not mentioned in precisely the same language in the 18th century Constitution. All presidents going back to George Washington have exercised some form of what we today call executive privilege. And in fact, I've written and argued that President Washington perhaps set the standard historically on the exercise of executive privilege, because when first confronted with the issue of whether the president has the right to withhold information from members of Congress in a particularly sensitive area, he called members of his cabinet for a discussion about whether this is a legitimate presidential power. And very interestingly, the president made the determination that this is a legitimate power of presidents, but it's only legitimate when exercised in the public interest and not when it's in the interest of the president politically to withhold information. That's the standard that all presidents should follow, but unfortunately not all have done so throughout our history. So in the modern era, of course, most famously, the abuses of President Nixon in his use of executive privilege, and then President Clinton during the Lewinsky scandal and a number of other occasions where he far overreached in claiming executive privilege, would stand as examples of where presidents, I think, have tried to shield information in order to withhold embarrassing information or information that might be very damaging in other ways, not because they were trying to protect the public interest from some form of disclosure that would harm the country. So, interestingly, in that case that I had mentioned regarding President Washington, he determined that disclosure was appropriate, even though he would have liked to have withheld information. And he asserted the principle to Congress very directly that in releasing the information that the members had requested, the documentation, he was not in any way minimizing his right as president in the future to claim this power.